Welcome to the Startup Grind.
So it's my great pleasure to introduce Baybars Altuntas, the Startup Grind Tirana.
When it is free, everyone is standing up. I enjoyed this. I don't know if it is going to be profitable for me, but I don't.
Welcome to Tirana.
Thank you.
Away from home.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank you very much to connect me with the Albanian Startup Grind community, first of all, because to tell you the truth, I didn't dream such kind of a community before coming here. I was expecting something different, but I faced with something that I didn't dream, and that is what I enjoyed very much, because this is my third time in Albania, and now I see the development in the last 3 years of the Albanian entrepreneurship ecosystem, which means it will be much different 3 years later. Perfect.
I have here your book.
Yes.
This is the Albanian version of the bus into a BMW.
Zprita niga autobusi hipane BMW. Correct? Or did you understand?
Kind of, yes. Yeah. Okay, I assume you talked in Albanian.
Yeah.
Okay, good. I read this book, it took me less than 24 hours to finish it. And everybody was surprised, they told me it's 300 pages. I was like, it seemed like it's 100 pages. So it's that interesting, and especially for young entrepreneurs, it's quite inspiring to learn many things of what to do and what not to do, especially in the first stages. So quite remarkable, and I've been reading a lot this month, me and my team. Very interesting book, and of course I want to advise everyone to read it, especially those entrepreneurs that would like to enter this journey. I want to start with I'm going to ask a lot of difficult questions, so I hope you're ready for it.
Depends on the question, of course.
Okay, so here's the first one. You mentioned in your book that the best decision you have ever made as an entrepreneur was marrying your wife, Rakiba.
Very entrepreneurial decision.
I changed it a little bit. I altered it. Okay. So, talk to us about the principle that entrepreneurs should be guided during their journey as entrepreneurs.
I can, of course, talk about the principles that I discovered. So, what I will tell you is true for me, but of course it is open to discussion. It doesn't mean the only truth in the world about entrepreneurship, of course. My entrepreneurship journey started from scratch. So I had to discover such a way that I had to set up my own business without any finance. Because I didn't have any money. I had just $400 studying at the university, staying at the dorm of the university, but I had business idea, which I believed very much. Nobody believed it, by the way. Maybe I will tell you some, give you some details in this interview, but the main principle of the entrepreneurship journey for me is, if you can convert idle capacity into cash, then you can become a very successful businessman in the future. If we are talking about entrepreneurship, we can talk about many things. But if we are going to talk about successful entrepreneurship, about the success in entrepreneurship, then you always have to engineer your mindset in such a way that your eyes will always concentrate on the idle capacity of your network.
How difficult is to spot this idle capacity?
If you have powerful eyes, it is not difficult. If you are looking at the door like everybody, of course it is very difficult. But if you see the door, as much of the people in the world cannot do, by the way, it is not so difficult. It is something very easy.
In your perspective, what has changed in the startup world in the past 10 years?
These are the difficult questions or the easy ones? I set up my own company in 1992 when I was 22 years old, when I was a student at the university. And I made $5 million in the first year. When I was 22 years old, my BMW was waiting for me in the garden of the door. So the name of the book is not a slogan. It's a reality. I was getting on the bus while going to the school, and 3 months later, my BMW was waiting for it. So what's changed from 1992 to now? First of all, Google and internet connection became the main source of success in entrepreneurial world. That was not the case 20 years ago, 25 years ago. In order to produce a business idea, you had to think about it. But now, even you don't have a business idea, you just Google business idea and you have millions of pages. So it is very easy to touch it. Even the business ideas in our pockets, even in our bedroom, everywhere. Even as you see on the Turkish Airlines advertisement campaign, it is in the flight. So it is everywhere. So the main change is producing a good business idea was not easy 25 years ago. Now it is easier. But now what is the difficult part of the story is everybody is able to touch this business idea. So there is another kind of competition to become more successful in the journey.
What makes a startup successful?
If the startup is able to use the network, mentorship, and know-how of the experienced entrepreneurs, of the serial entrepreneurs, of the experienced angel investors, then he is much closer to the success. Why? That was not the case 25 years ago. Because I didn't have so many competitors in the market. But now, the startup of today, the entrepreneur of today, wherever he is in Albania, in Cyprus, in Turkey, in the United States, wherever he has to know how to use network, mentorship, and know-how. So this is the one of the, by the way, differences between what happened in the last 25 years.
You mentioned in your book that entrepreneurship success is a marathon, not a sprint. What do you mean by that?
As a matter of fact, the question is, can you become the entrepreneur by learning it, or are you born as an entrepreneur? So I believe that the ball comes to the foot of everybody. There is an equal distribution of the opportunities in the world. Some of them can take it and convert it to gold. Some of them. For example, if you read my book, isn't it? So in the book, I give an anecdote about how I minded to set up the franchise association in Turkey. There was an article about franchising. I didn't know the meaning of the word. And I just read the article to learn the meaning of the word, what the franchising was. 20,000 people read the same article like me, because the subscription amount of the magazine was 20,000. Everybody passed the page, but I faxed to the German Franchise Association and invited them to come to Turkey and try to transfer the know-how which was available in the world. So I think this is important. I mean, everybody looked at the page, but I saw the page.
Because I remember also one of the things that local, let's say, the shops in Turkey pride was that we have the only one shop here in Istanbul, for instance. We don't have it in many other cities. So I think it was also bring into the local mentality of also the franchising.
This is the question I also answered on CNN International. He asked me what like differences you see between the Middle East entrepreneurial ecosystem and the American entrepreneurial ecosystem. I want to give the same answer. When you visited a kebab house or a shop in Turkey, you see an A4 paper on the wall, and it writes, "We don't have any branch office anywhere in the world." And this entrepreneur is proud of this. He is proud of not having any branch office anywhere in the world. But if you check the press releases of McDonald's, McDonald's is saying we have 5,000 branch offices all over the world, and this entrepreneur is also proud of this. So I think this is an interesting challenge between the two ecosystems.
You mentioned before that you started your first business with only $400 in your pocket. How likely is now for a young guy who has a crazy idea and wants to start something but has no capital? How difficult is for him to start and to start a good business?
I spent $400. If I would be the entrepreneur of today starting the same business, I wouldn't spend even $1.
Okay.
Because today's marketing channels are more than the marketing channels of yesterday. If you advertise it at the Facebook, most of the time it is free. If you use social media, it is free. If you use LinkedIn, Instagram, it is free. In order to create a success story in the entrepreneurial journey, you have to smell money. In order to smell money, you have to first understand if there is a demand from the market for your service or product. This understanding process costed $400 to me in 1992. Now it costs nothing. So it is easier to do it now.
But still, once you find this and you market, okay, you market it for free, but then you need capital to build it. So then how difficult is to raise capital for local startups without losing their company in a way?
If you cannot use the idle capacity of your network, of course you need capital. If you are able to use, if you have such kind of a skill, you don't have a capital. For example, what did I do? I set up a language course in Istanbul. That's fine. But if I was born in Albania, and if I have an idea to set up a language course in Albania, as a matter of fact, I don't need money. Because, however, there are many universities here, and I know Mr. Rector, and I visit Mr. Rector, I make an agreement with his university, and I convert the classes he doesn't use in the university into cash by bringing new clients from Facebook. So this is a simple business model. This is a mindset. You can, of course, develop this business model to every business, not just for language course you can use it even while producing new products.
Talking about products, in your perspective, what makes a great product?
Innovation, of course. I mean, if I am going to sell this water, and if the other guy is selling this for $1 for the last 10 years at the corner of the street, and if I come to the other corner of the street and try to sell it again by asking for $1, there's a great risk here. Why? Because I'm going to spend for marketing, isn't it? The customer is going to see my billboards, will get thirsty, and will go to my competitor to buy it because he has been doing the same business for the last 10 years. Customer, consumer, and user are the most intelligent creatures of the world. They don't love risk. But if I advertise my product by claiming that it is $1, mine is also $1, and you have been drinking this for the last 10 years, but try this one, you will dream better tonight. Then the customer will say, "Ah, it's $1, this is $1, let me try it. All of us are customers, isn't it? Let me try it." This "let me try it" is the key word of the success. If you can lead the customer to say "let me try it," this is the beginning of the journey. If he finds your claim as a reality, then you are the successful businessman of the future. So product should be innovative. If you cannot bring an innovation to your marketing strategy, to your product, to your process, then you are going to take a risk. If you are a smart entrepreneur, that means you will not love risk so much. If you are not going to love the risk so much, then you have to innovate.
But then we go to the product, and another very important thing for young founders is to build the right business model. So talk to us about what's maybe a good approach or a right approach to build the right business model, which can be easy, understandable even by investors or angels for that startup or for that product.
You know, we have two sides of brain, right side, left side. And right side of our brain is the center of imagination, isn't it? We dream, we produce new business ideas with our right side of the brain. Left side is dealing with maths, with risks, tries to catch the empty side of the bottle. Right side deals with the full side of the bottle, left concentrates on the left, the empty side of the bottle. So we are going to create with our right brain the business model. And the business plan is something different than the business model. Left side of our brain is going to produce the business plan. So which one is important according to you? Since you are organizing startup grind events and inviting so many people to here, then I'm asking you the question, right side or left side? Business model or business plan? Which one is more important for the successful entrepreneur, not for the entrepreneur?
Well, I would say the business model.
Yes, now I agree that you invited so many people. Right side of the business model is more difficult to produce than producing the business plan. And unfortunately, what I see in the world, entrepreneurs are encouraged to produce business plans first, then the business models. Everybody has a business plan, Excel sheets, etc. But where is the business model? Because business model is going to take you to convert your business into money. So business model is very important, and let's come to your question. Can you repeat the question again?
How can startups build the startups build models?
With their right, by their right brain.
Okay, send the right brain an email or something. Let's talk a little bit about teams and co-founders. The most important thing of the founder in the beginning is to build the right team. In your perspective, how can young entrepreneurs deal with the urgency to hire the first one that comes? They have a great idea, but they need to find the right founder, because founders are critical to the success, especially in the beginning of the startup. So how can young founders resist the tendency to hire the first one that comes into their way, even though they're not the right one, and then wait until they find the right person to build their business?
I think the question is simply, you are asking if investing in the right team is important or invested by the right team. Because investing in the right team is, of course, important for the angel investors. But for startups, for entrepreneurs, finding the correct founder is very important. That means invested by the right team is sometimes more important than the entrepreneur itself. In order to find the correct team of founders, I think the most important thing, the approach of entrepreneurs should be to feel themselves like recruiting staff for their projects. Founder is also a staff, is a member of the team. And you entrepreneurs have to check the track record, CVs, profiles of the investors, of the founders also. And while checking the biographies of the founders, I think we are all agree with the fact that getting finance for the project is not enough for the success of the business. So you have to check what like a know-how, mentorship, network this founder can provide you.
What advice do you have for people who have a great idea, who want to start something, but they're not sure about their journey ahead?
I mean, first of all, they have to understand that this entrepreneurial journey is not a short 100 meters running
sprint.
Yes, but unfortunately, most of the startups of today accept finding money as a success. You ask me what are the difference between of today and 25 years ago, I don't remember that we used the term, terminology like finding money. I don't remember it. Setting up a business was a success. Now, finding money, raising funds, started to become a criteria of the startup success, which is totally wrong, by the way, of course. But this is the reality. So in this journey, they have to understand that this journey is a marathon, not a sprint. And this marathon is not just creating the business idea. We discussed about the value of the business idea alone. Most of the startups, unfortunately, are believing that their business idea is equal to the 50% of the company. And we, at the EBAN community, decided by asking to approximately 1,000 angel investors that the maximum value of a business idea is maximum 5%. If you have just a business idea, then you can own the maximum 5% of the company. If you have the ability to implement your business idea as an entrepreneur, then you get 10% more. If you have some experience, you get 5% more. It goes up like that. So I think everybody has to be aware of that. This 5% is just the beginning of the journey. You have to innovate, you have to set up your company, then marketing and sales, institutionalization, branding, franchising, leadership, and there are 9 steps that you have to follow. So it's a marathon, it's not a sprint. We are just talking about the entrepreneurship stage, which is creating the business idea. But this is just the beginning. What about the innovation? What about setting up the business? What about creating the team? What about creating the future projects of your business? They all come together and create a marathon way. So,
tell us about some time when you failed, or something that you invested in didn't go the way you planned. What lessons did you learn from it?
From failures.
Yes.
My biggest failure became non-financial, not a financial failure. I couldn't succeed to deal with the human resources management of my company. There were 500 people working in my company in 12 cities, and I couldn't succeed to develop a professional human resources management from my side. This became a big failure for me, because this failure also opened a new door for me. I changed my business model. I converted each of my school to a franchise business, and I decided to franchise them to independent entrepreneurs. And at the end of the 4 years, again, I owned 12 schools, but now each of them was managed by independent entrepreneurs, and I was using my know-how mentorship for these independent entrepreneurs. So, yes, I am not good at human resources management, but I created another opportunity from my failure for myself.
What about something you invested in didn't go right? I remember one of the stories you had at Dragon Den, when you the one at the Brick Factory was interesting.
Brick Factory is, of course, an interesting one. I invested in 11 startups at the Dragon's Den, and I wrote one by one what happened in each of them, and anyone who wants to learn which startups they were, you can visit the Wikipedia page of me. And in the Brick Factory, the entrepreneur was approximately 50 years old, and he was graduated from the chemical department of the university. And he came to the stage by claiming that we would produce the cheapest bricks of the world, and we would produce the cheapest buildings of the world. Of course, it's a very good project, because you are bringing an innovation to the market, and this is going to create going to be a radical innovation all over the world. And if you think just India, and if you convert, as he claimed, the wasted papers into bricks, then that would be marvelous. And because he was the expert of chemistry, and he spent all his life for chemistry, and because he used the chemical labs of the university in Istanbul, then we agreed on the stage to develop this business and set up the first factory in the world, which is going to produce bricks from wasted papers. That was a perfect project. Then he, but with one condition, I said, he came to the stage without any scientific report. I said, I am going to pay for the report payments, and you are going to receive these reports. As soon as we receive the reports, because he claimed reports are wonderful, there is no problem, etc., then we will set up the factory, that's all. He brought the reports from the university 3 months later. I paid the account, and the report was very positive. Everything was perfect. Then, of course, I couldn't sleep, because when I calculated the amounts, then I think I would create 5 Facebooks or 10 Apples in the world. So, what happened as a result? We made a press release and invited media for such kind of a radical innovation in the world. Media started to write about this. There is an revolution in the construction industry of the world, and this entrepreneur with the dragon, they are going to set up the company, etc. Then, the fifth biggest factory producing bricks of the world was in Ankara, and the CEO called me. He said, okay, that is very interesting. We read it on media, and we want to invest in this business, and we want to become the stakeholder of this company. Of course, that was something great from the motivational part of the business. We made a meeting in Ankara. He invited all R&D department. They were approximately 20 people. And they said, instead of setting up the factory, let's add some supplementary materials to our factory and you produce it here. And we export it to the world. So instead of losing time by going to clients, then next week we'll start producing it. Perfect. And he said, report is here, our R&D team is here, everything is perfect. Please leave us the demo brick, because he also produced a demo brick. And the next morning, I received an email from the CEO with the photograph of the brick we left, which is showing how it was after just putting this brick into water just for 2 hours. It was paper. So, project was, what I discovered, and I immediately forwarded to the entrepreneur, because the chemical report, the university report was positive, but of course there were many scientific terms which I couldn't understand. But as a result, it was positive. What was not positive was, he didn't include, I don't know how it happened, the report didn't include the resistance of the brick against the water. Then I said, okay, it is not a problem. We can create it. Yes, there are some chemicals which, if you put these chemicals to the production the process, then of course it is becoming resistance. But it is becoming, you are producing a more expensive brick which is in the market. So this is a totally out of the date project. So you asked about this, and I wanted to explain a little bit in detail. So I think the transparency while bringing the projects to investors is something that entrepreneurs should give also importance to.
When you talk about motivation, how can an entrepreneur build a mental toughness and resilience and get motivated when he deals with all the crap that we deal every day?
In my book, there's a chapter, 7, 24, 365. Those are the numbers an entrepreneur has to love. 7 days, 24 hours, 365 days. If you are dreaming a life like you are taking your daughters to tennis courts at the weekend and taking them as the family going to cinema every Sunday, then entrepreneurship is not for you. You can become a very good CEO, maybe the best CEO of the world, but not the best entrepreneur of the world. So if you are dedicating your every second to the entrepreneurial journey, then it is impossible you to demotivate yourself. You can go to bankrupt. Your staff can leave the job. Anything can happen. An earthquake happens and you lose your factory. Anything can happen. Anything happens as negative is a new start, motivation for the next project for the entrepreneurs. This is the psychology of the entrepreneur. If you don't have such kind of a psychology, and if you feel that at the end of your first fall, then if you are thinking that entrepreneurship is not something for you, yes, it is not something for you. As Henry Ford said, if you say you can do it, I agree with you. If you say you cannot do it, I agree with you.
Let's talk a little bit about financing. I am a startup in a small country like Albania, and I dream to go global. So my mentality is that I don't want to do a product for my local market. My local market is too small and too competitive. I want to do something that goes out immediately from day one to the world. At which point in point of view should an entrepreneur and a startup founder look for financing?
If you want to go global immediately, then IT and mobile technologies, e-businesses, e-commerce businesses are the practical way to start. And it is not just practical, it is also logical. Why? Because 25% of the investment money in the world is going to ICT, IT, mobile, e-businesses, etc. And this is bringing a real opportunity for anybody in the world. If you have an internet connection and if you have a great business idea, then the stage is yours. I gave a speech in Northern Cyprus part, and one of the students asked me a question. He said, "Mr. Altuntas, what are you talking about?" There were 1,000 students in the university, in the room. And this northern part of Cyprus, there are embargo, etc. We are not even able to export our orange to anyone. And you came here and talking about entrepreneurship, setting up your business, etc. So it means nothing for me, what you said. And I asked the question, okay, everything is negative and there are embargo for everything in the ecosystem. Good. But embargo for also internet connection. He said no. Then, yes, you are asking me what are you talking about. Now I am asking you, what are you talking about? Because 25% of the money investors in the world is going to ICT, IT, mobile, internet-based businesses. If you have a business idea, wherever you are in the world, then the success directly is related with your own right brain, I see. So I think Albania, Turkey, States, or whatever, the advantage of today is there is an equal opportunity for everybody if they have a good internet connection. And in Turkey, I advise entrepreneurs not to ask many things from the government. Just one thing, a good free internet connection. That's enough. I didn't own it in 1992. But now everybody has it. Better connection is much better. And if the governments, policymakers provide internet connection for the startups, for everybody. That's enough.
Good. We have two policymakers in the audience here, so yeah. I think they get inspired as well.
I think I am easing their job, isn't it now?
Oh yeah, that's for sure.
They will just now accelerate the speed of the internet, and they will say, okay, this is what we did for entrepreneurs. Yeah.
When an entrepreneur decides to welcome on board an angel investor,
yeah.
In your perspective, what relationship should he strive to establish with her or him?
I think what I observe while listening to the pitchings of entrepreneurs is they are not aware of the fact that angel investors listening to them also were entrepreneurs and are still entrepreneurs. Entrepreneur is entrepreneur, but angel investor is investor and entrepreneur. That's very important. I had made a pitching before setting up my company to a very good entrepreneur, successful entrepreneur in Turkey. And he said, no, this idea doesn't work. You cannot make money with this idea. And I cannot invest for this. But he was an entrepreneur coming from scratch. He was very successful. I visited him many times, and at last he said, how much do you have? $400, I said. Okay, he said, come here. Sit down here, here's the computer. Prepare your advertisement. Advertise your business idea. Spend your $400. You lose this $400 and then I will be very happy because I don't want to see you anymore in the office. My answer is interesting. I said, let me think about it. He said, what are you going to think about it? You visited me hundreds of times here and spent my time and you claimed that it was a very successful, it was a very profitable business. Now you are just going to spend $400 and you are saying, let me think about it. Because it is my money, isn't it? So when entrepreneurs came to me and made pitching, I know their psychology very well. If I ask them to put $100 for this business, they will answer me, let me think about it. So I think this is something very important. What the relationship between the angel investor and entrepreneur should be, it should be very transparent. And both sides should know that they should speak the same language. If they don't use the transparent words, if they don't share what is in their mind very clearly, this is valid for both sides, by the way, very clearly, they should know that it is going to create an unsustainable business for the future.
What is your biggest goal or dream you haven't achieved yet?
This is a difficult question.
I wanted to end it with one.
For example, if you would ask me when I was 21 years old, what is your goal in the life, I couldn't, or your expected achievement for the future, I couldn't say that I will set up a company and in 2 years of time, this company is going to become the one of the 100 franchise brands of Turkey. I couldn't say it. If you would ask me for example, I couldn't also dream to become a guest of President Obama at the White House. Or I couldn't dream to interview like you with President Obama and become the only entrepreneur in the world he wanted to interview personally. Those are the things that I couldn't dream. So, in order to answer your question, I have to sleep tonight and try to see tomorrow. Some dreams and answer your questions tomorrow.
We're going to spread it through social media once we have the answer.
Yeah.
So, okay.
Okay.
Let's give a round of applause to Baybars. And I'd like to invite everyone to read this book. It's very inspiring. It inspired me. I came also up with a new crazy idea, by the way, but I'm not going to share it right now.
Don't do it. Yeah. If it is crazy, don't.
Yeah, it's really crazy. But yeah, I got inspired, and yes, as you said, at least for hundreds of mistakes entrepreneurs do, if they read this book, they're going to avoid to around 100 less mistakes in their startup journey. So it's a great book. So where can people buy it? So we have it in Albanian. I got it on Amazon.
Which at Amazon.com, its English version can be downloaded for Kindle, by the way. And you can also buy the Albanian version online. And you can find it everywhere in Kosovo, in Albania, at the bookstores. And I also advise you to buy a magazine, not just my book, the Global Woman magazine. Woman entrepreneurship is very important in the world. And this is, I think, all everybody should encourage. Because maybe it is not a problem in Albania, but in many countries, women are not able to implement their business ideas so easily. So I am personally giving particular importance for women entrepreneurship. And I am also the head of the Women Entrepreneurship Committee of the World Entrepreneurship Forum in France. And this Global Woman is a magazine that all Albanians, I think, should proud of, because the producer is from Albania, Mirela. Is producing this in UK.
And she is here tonight.
And she is here. And by the way, if you start reading the magazine from the sixth page, you will see my article. I'm answering the women entrepreneurs' questions about entrepreneurship. So I think Mirela is also deserving very powerful applause. Yeah. From us.
On top of it, I would like to just add that this month, May, it's the Women Entrepreneurs Month at Startup Grind. So we have over 100 chapters worldwide promoting women entrepreneurs in their events. Of course, for this month, I made an exception because of you. But Startup Grind supports 40 Forward, the Google for Entrepreneurs initiatives, which supports women. Entrepreneurs in their local environment. So Startup Grind Tirana has continuously supported women entrepreneurs. We had two so far. Linda Shom is here, and we also had Amarda Tosca at our fourth event. So, and we're going to continue to do that because, as you said, for women also in Albania, it's hard to sort of set up a business specialist from scratch.
Yeah.
So, and I think it's a general issue. Okay, so now the floor is open for your questions to Baybars.
Easy questions, please, because difficult ones came from here.
First of all, it's a great pleasure to have you tonight here.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I have studied entrepreneurship at the University of Pittsburgh, US. So I have some question for you. It's said that death and wealth, or money, is destined by God. Do you agree with it? First. Second, they had a theory that entrepreneurs, in order to be successful, must have first character. Second, should spend time in the nature. And third, they should be really very sincere with their employees. With Which one of these do you agree most? The third question.
But I said easy question, but yeah. Yes, please.
If I am, let's say, an entrepreneur, what's your due diligence if I come to you?
Okay. Let me start from the easiest one, from the last one. If you are an entrepreneur, my due diligence is not going to become about your business project. It will be about you. If you are the correct entrepreneur or not, this is important. Because if you are a good sportsman or not, that's very important. You are coming with a ball in your hand and claiming that, Baybars, come here. We are going to set up a football club. We are going to be very rich. And I am the football player, number one, etc. This is your project, okay? I try to understand if you are really a football player or a sportsman. If I understand that you are a good sportswoman, then even the project you bring to me is not sensible for me, because maybe setting up a football club will not be so profitable, but setting up a ping pong ball club will be, or basketball club will be very profitable. If I understand you are a good sportswoman, then come here. Instead of setting up a football club, let's do this. It is better. So I'm not so much interested in the due diligence issue in your project first, then of course the project. But let's not forget that there are many good projects all over the world. But number of good projects are much more than the good entrepreneurs. So what we need is the good entrepreneur first, than the good project. Let's come to your first part, luck, destiny, etc. This question answer changes from person to person. If you ask this question to a believer who believes in God, answer will differ. If you ask this to a non-believer, the answer is going to differ. I'm a believer, so I will answer it from this perspective. So, I believe that the God is behaving very acute to everybody in the world. If you want something, he is, or she is, or the God is bringing the ball to your foot, but he's not making the goal. You are responsible to convert this ball to goal. So I think this is important. But you have to understand that the ball is there. There are so many people who doesn't even perceive the ball as an opportunity, or who's not aware that there is a ball that he can convert to goal. What were the other options? You are the second and the third.
Nature, character. Sincere.
They're all very important, of course. I mean, for example, the last one, sincere to staff, to employee, is very important. Human resource management, etc., is very important. They're all very important. I mean, I cannot discriminate which one is more important or not.
Yeah, that's what I wanted.
The order.
One. Just pick one, please.
I think respect to staff is coming first for me. Why? Because this is the point, as I told you in the interview, I failed. So.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Pyetje tjetër?
It is very quick. How do entrepreneurs deal with informality? And informality, how do you keep motivating yourself as an entrepreneur when you see that maybe it's not the balance between formality and informality goes more on the informal part than to the formal one.
How do I? Yeah.
Not playing by the rules.
Not playing by the rules.
By the rules. Yeah, the regulations. You mean? Yeah. If you are creating an innovative business idea, that means you are going to deal with the regulation problems very much. Because if it is a new idea, then that means there is no regulation about it. When I first organized the flight attendant course in Turkey, I found myself at the court. Because nobody did it until then. And National Minister of Education sent me to the court because I was doing something illegal, according to the regulation. But what happened, I discovered that the law system is working very well in Turkey, very well. You are going to the court, he is asking your identity, etc., and inviting you 6 months later, because he is very full. So I said, there's a wonderful system. So what's happening in these 6 months? You are going on making money. Oh, that's fine. Then I converted this excellent system to an opportunity. I spent these 6 months to legalize my flight attendance course by visiting the Minister of Education. And what happened? Minister of Education approved the program in 12 months and nothing happened at the court. But as a result of this process, yes, it was a very stressful process, Turkey owned a very new vocational training program, which everybody could do. So such kind of a radical innovation happened as a result not caring the regulations, to be honest. So you have to take the risk. If money is coming, then you deal with the regulation.
You mentioned that the difference between the business model and the business plan, and I understood in the point that when we talk for the business model, we involve our right brain, and when we talk for the business plan, we involve our left brain, meaning that the most of the people that want to start a business are concerned about the house, how I'm going to do it, while the real business model is concerned about the why and the what's. That is why we sell.
Business model is dealing with house, mostly, and business plan is dealing with what. Because how is a very important question.
The house meaning how I'm going to do marketing, how I'm going to
how
do
are
the
you
selling,
going to create the innovation, how are you yes,
create,
how
yes.
are you going to bring this product with the minimum budget to the market,
okay.
for example.
But because of people are most concerned about the house, how it happens that we have a very limited number of successful entrepreneurs in the world, while the others are not succeeding? Because a business plan can be sound, and it's logic because of the involvement of the left brain, but it's not seeing the passion there, the objectives, the goal, the thinking process, why I'm going to do it. As you mentioned, you have a why you did it, and nothing stopped you, even if an earthquake was happening.
Even I go to court.
Many years ago.
Yeah.
And that is my question. And the second is that, do you think that these subjects should be part of the curricula since the kindergarten and the elementary school, and not letting people becoming entrepreneurs when they are almost set up, when they are 20 years old or 22 years old?
I think this is a very important point. I mean, redesigning the curriculums worldwide, which will bring entrepreneurial training even to the kindergarten. If, for example, I'm the father of two daughters, and I gave entrepreneurial training for them when they were 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old. And my training, for example, was What is this? I was asking. This is a box, cola box. That's good. Okay. Can you use it like a pencil box? Yes. If it is a cola box, then it will go to waste box. But if it's a pencil box, then you can make money because you can sell it. So how you see it is important. So pencil box, all cola boxes at home became pencil boxes, and they were sold in the classroom to their friends by them. First of all, I wanted to teach them selling something to a friend is not something that you have to shame. It is not something bad. Because I'm coming from a family, my father had 6 brothers. They were all working for the government. My mother, 6 brothers, all working for the government. My grandfather was an elementary school teacher. Grandmother, inspector. So I came from a home environment that even speaking about money was something not good. So I didn't want my daughters to leave such kind of things. Talking about money should be something, an ordinary thing. At least they should understand that selling something is something good. It is, you are creating a value there. And this is something they can learn even when they are 5 years, 6 years old. But if you carry this into the curriculums, then this means this is not just going to become a personal training of Baybars for his daughters, but it is going to be an education for everybody's sons and daughters. So that's very important. I totally agree with you. Entrepreneurial training should start as soon as they are born, from the first day. They should talk maybe about money when they are 1 year old around them. So I don't know, but the first word they should learn is to pronounce money. Then about your house. There are 2 ways about house. You can learn how to do it by going to seminars, reading books, etc. Or studying it. That is what you can do. Or you can discover the house by yourself. Both ways take you to the same result. So if you are not able to discover it by yourself, then please read it, study it, attend the conferences, follow Startup Grind in Tirana, and please always alert your brain for the new input coming about entrepreneurship. This is something that you can do for yourself as a personal trainer of yourself. Of course, Mirela.
Afrobat?
I wanted to make this question publicly.
Please.
I haven't seen the model of a businessman like you being so modest and down to earth. Can you please teach us how can we be successful and not showing off all the time that I have money? Because the only person that I have seen recently doing that is you. How can we achieve this?
This is, I think, Mirela, something related with your mindset. That's a good question, as a matter of fact. Not maybe for myself, but the definition of success in the beginning is quite different than the definition of success of today for me. In the beginning of the journey, there was only one definition of success for me: to download as much as possible money to my bank account from the markets. This is the criteria of success. If I had more money in 1993 than 1992, then I felt more successful. But after you saved some cash in your bank account, the definition of success is changing. Then the definition of success is becoming to give to the world, not to download, to upload the world. It is related with your mindset, but this is not, I understand your question. Everybody is not like this, you said. This is the engineering of the mindset, I think. This is my mindset. I enjoy speaking here with new startups more than checking my Excel sheet from my iPhone of today. But another person may not agree with me about this. Another businessman cannot. Everybody, has, I think, will have a different answer to this question.
I totally agree with you, because especially here at Startup Grind, would like rather to give more than to take.
Yeah.
So we're in the right path when it comes to our definition also of success. So
please don't forget that, for example, even you invite Bill Gates here, I'm sure he will come. I'm sure.
I'm working on it.
Yeah, yeah, you can do it. Everybody is laughing now, as you see. They are thinking that
let's
he will
see
not come.
Laugh last, you know?
Then I send a message to President Obama. They said, who is Obama? Who is you? Who said it? Including my wife. Now my wife is saying, because I will probably meet with President Obama again in Nairobi on the 24th of July. He is going to Kenya. Now she is saying, if you are saying, most probably it will happen. Instead of believing others, let the others believe in you. This became my strategy.
One last question. The fresh packs, I came in, so you can wear this.
I have a direct question. As an angel investor or somebody investing money in IT startups, is it worth it investing here? Because almost 99% of the startups are failing, especially for the youngsters who really have an idea. After a week, they fail, they don't see money, and they just leave it.
Yeah. Iler, I think. Your name is Iler. Iler. Your left brain is working very well. Question is correct. There is no problem with the question.
All right.
But your right brain, I think, should also understand the psychology of the people in the world. For example, if there would be a statistics like this, the 90% of the graduates of faculty of education are not able to find job. Or 90% of doctors who graduate from
medical... He's not in that scenario. In startups, that's higher. That's the point.
Let me complete. And doctors are not employed. Nobody will prefer studying at the medical university, isn't it? Or at the faculty of education, because statistics show that they are not, they won't be able to, 90% of them will not be able to find job. There is only one very exceptional area where everybody knows that 90% are falling and still everybody wants to become the entrepreneur. Psychology of the people. Everybody knows that most of them are going to fail. And still, 90% of the people want to become their own boss, to lead their own business. So this is a psychological issue. Question is right, but the right brain also should perceive the psychology of the people.
Okay, anyway, the question was like, investing on these guys or not investing?
Investing.
Because if you have the money, you are just thinking, do I have to invest here or I invest in real estate? Or in another, not IT, but I mean fast food or another kind of business.
This is
because you know the stats, how it is. Less than 1% are doing the money.
10 days ago, I was in Bahrain for Angel Investors Summit. A similar question came. In Middle East countries, investment is going to real estate because they see concretely what they invested in, isn't it? And Bahrain ecosystem is not, the Gulf ecosystem is not able to convince investors to invest in the dreams of startups. Why he is going to put $200,000 to a startup instead of buying a flat, which will become certain $300,000 5 years or 10 years later? This is an entrepreneurial ecosystem challenge. This is not the case in the United States, but it is the case in Gulf area. So that means everybody in the world is not thinking in the same way, isn't it? Why the people in the United States or in France are investing in the dreams of the startups but not the others? This is a mindset development. Such kind of conferences, such kind of awareness issues is going to accelerate this process, I think.
Maybe they send their companies in the IPO, so they send them.
Maybe.
And there is a lot of money after that, but Albanian companies is a bit difficult, or even Turkish companies.
Yeah.
And Twitter,
I think we
nobody
have to
knows how much money is Twitter doing.
I think, again, we have to understand the psychology of the investors. If I have money, if there's a startup here, and if I am able to dream that with this startup I am going to leave my 25 years ago days, the excitement while going to job, etc. This is something that I cannot buy with money. And this entrepreneur is creating an opportunity for me to leave my youth days, maybe. And this is something invaluable, and I cannot immediately answer your question with my left brain.
Please give Baybars a great round of applause. Thank you very much for being tonight with our community here at Startup Grind Tirana. We hope to see you again.
Thank you very much.
And good luck with your meetings during these 2 days.
Thank you. And I also congratulate you because you are really creating a good entrepreneurial ecosystem in Albania. 2 years ago, there was no startup grind, isn't it, in Albania?
Yes.
And if I am now able to talk directly with the real entrepreneurial spirits in Albania, this is thanks to you. So I think he's also deserving a powerful applause.
Yes, thank you. Now we're going to have another hour of networking or less, because okay. I know you have to run your delegation. But for a quick question, you can contact Baybars right away, right now.
From Facebook.
All from Facebook.
LinkedIn, from Twitter, from everywhere.
Yeah, so it's very responsive. I tried it myself. That's how I invited him through LinkedIn. So and he accepted. Yeah. All right, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
One more thing. I want to also thank the Marie Barnett University for hosting us. The chancellor is here. And please check the business magazine.
Rector, sorry.
And please check the business magazine issue. You can view it here or download it online. All right, so see you at the next event.